Thanks. I'm Adam Pitcher. I just a concerned citizen, I guess. I organized a rally there last Thursday at Federation Building. At the turnout, I'm really glad to see everybody coming out, and there's so many people that's been jumping on board. It's amazing. I gotta admit, I made a mistake last Thursday. Unlike the Liberal government, I can admit I made a mistake. I said there was 35,000 unemployed in the province, but its last figure was 39,400. So I'm one of those. I hope not to be, but this budget is. Budget is really pushing us into the ground for sure. I have something I'd like to say. I mean, Dale Kirby is saying that what we're saying here tonight is nonsense. Kathy Bennett says it's a bunch of baloney. I mean, if I was to get up here and say that, I'd be ran out the door pretty quick, you know? Like, we need to stand up and fight for ourselves, so. I'm not much of a public speaker, I'm a bit nervous, sorry, so. I'm sure I'm going to get a lot of practice now over the next little while. I just want to say that that Friday coming, April 29th, 10 a.m., the parking lot of the Avalon Mall next to Sears, we'll be having a big rally. Well, we'll be starting at the Avalon Mall and marching to the Confederation Building. This will be a grassroots rally with speakers from many concerned community groups, and there will be an opportunity for concerned citizens to share their stories. Every politician has been invited to attend. All the unions, so many community groups, we've been reaching out and really, really pushing this. A lot of us are so exhausted, it's been 24/7 for us on social media and getting on open line. And it's a big push. I'm really impressed at how many people are stepping up to the plate here. It's great.
Time again?
It's 10 a.m. Friday morning, Avalon Mall next to Sears. Yeah. So it's a family-friendly and peaceful demonstration of solidarity. Volunteers will be leading the march, and they'll be wearing orange vests. The march will be along sidewalks, and there's a hospital along the route, so we must ensure to give emergency vehicles right away. Not interfere with traffic at all, of course. People with mobility issues can meet anywhere along the route or at the rally points at the Avalon Mall or the Confederation Building. We'll probably end up at the Confed Building around 11:30, I would assume, after everything's said and done. If you need assistance during the march, we're here to help. If anybody needs a push in a wheelchair, or you know, we're everybody's here together in this, right? So we'd like to see everybody get out who can, for sure. Parking will be at the Avalon Mall, of course, Pippi Park, Petten Building on Strawberry Marsh Road. There's very few visitor parking spaces at the Confederation Building, because I guess they don't want, 10,000 people showing up and complaining about things, so they've designed that pretty well, but we'll get there. Transportation, what's that, sorry? There's transportation, yeah, just getting to that. Metro bus serves the route, so there's Metro bus running between the college and North Atlantic, which is pretty much just across the road from the Confed Building. I believe I'm not entirely sure if it stops at the Confed Building or if there's something along.
Yes.
It does?
Yeah, the bus stops at the north end of the east block.
Okay,
yeah.
Perfect. There's Metro bus for that. Anybody with mobility issues, Jiffy Cab and Newfound Cabs have accessibility vans. We've contacted every cab company and they're all in support of us. They'll be along the route honking, I'm sure. This affects everybody, absolutely. There's a Go bus, actually, as well, that the City of St. John's runs, I believe. They can be contacted and it has to be booked 24 hours in advance. It's for groups and individuals. There's also a rideshare and a carpool website. Information can be found at groupcarpool.com. If anybody has any questions about anything, you can call me personally. My name is Adam Pitcher, P-I-T-C-H-E-R. Or I can be reached on Facebook, or my phone number is 770-7090. Yeah, I hope to see you all there. Thanks.
Thanks for that, Adam, and congratulations on taking the bull by the horns. Adam, I appreciate it. Adam, I appreciate it. If you have a chat for a minute after, I'll catch you from, okay, thanks. Go ahead. Oh, here's a heartbroken Chicago Blackhawks fan. I'm like one.
I'm still a proud Hawks fan. Donnie, I got to apologize for the color of my jacket. But I'm really proud, Bishop Barron, tell you so. First thing I wanted to, my name is Derek Windsor, but I wanted to ask Ralph, he made a statement, he said, they put on the table, and I was going to ask you, Ralph, what did they put on the table, McDonald's burgers? I thought they were feeding you. I came here tonight and I took off a copy of a post I put on the VOCM page underneath Mr. Ball's picture there. So, and I was going to read it out, but I changed my mind after I got here. It's there on the webpage to read out. You know, you can go to the webpage and take a look at it. I've been involved in the community for as long as I can remember. And I was involved with the school boards. Up to the time that they made that one school board. And I'm looking at Mr. Minister Kirby and looking at him before and after. And when Minister Kirby was a member of the NDP, he was completely against this one school board. And then he turned red and he was, well, I think we might have to look at it, or yeah, maybe da da da. So to me, this budget is all about integrity, and this government is about the lack of integrity. All of a sudden, Mr. Kirby, classroom size is not an issue to you anymore. About 3 years ago, when you were out at Whitburn, classroom size was an issue. When you were down at Holy Cross, classroom size was an issue. Why all of a sudden is it not an issue anymore? Dollars and cents, Mr. Kirby, and if it's the dollars might be fine, but you got no sense. This minister is bringing us back to a time when I went to school. When I went to Bishop's, we had 35, 40, even as high as 50 people in a class. And that might have been fine at that time. Teaching was a little different, but the classroom is different now. And I'm going to tell you, I can't say where it came from, but I'm going to tell you, I seen a letter of apology written by a grade 12 student that, for something that happened. And if you were to look at it, one, the penmanship, you could hardly read it. And two, you would think it was written by a grade 2 student. Yeah. And this is somebody we have put through our education system because of the holes that were in it. And now the holes are getting even bigger because we're making them bigger by making more people. How is a kindergarten classroom going to operate with 26 kids in it? Yes, you might have two teachers, but they haven't made the rooms bigger. They haven't added on. And all of a sudden, you're talking about wasting money. We got a steel structure down in Virginia Park. They're sitting there like a climbing machine for kids because someone hadn't got the balls to finish it. And we as taxpayers, as far as I'm concerned, deserve to have that structure finished. The kids of Virginia Park deserve to have that finished. We just went through a public consultation. I mean, I sat on the other side of the table of these consultations. And I'm very proud to say that every time there was a public vote, I stood up and I told the people in the room how I was voting. Whether I was voting for them or against them, it didn't make any difference. And I voted to close buildings and I told the people why. And they called me names and I went over and I spoke to them afterwards, and that's fine. But I didn't worry about writing down on a piece of paper and not telling someone because somebody was going to hurt my business. One of the reasons I'm here tonight is because I am now a business operator. And by every tax that goes on, that's every little bit of disposable income that will not be available to help me as a business owner. People won't have the funds. They won't have the ability to go out and spend that extra time here on a vacation or whatever. That's going to hurt my business. And the last thing before I sit down, the biggest thing for me right now that puzzles me the most is the liberals and social media. I don't know if anyone follows Twitter or Facebook, but when Mr. Lane was a PC before the blue turned red, and Mr. Andrew Parsons, the Twitter line was just continuous. The open line was continuous. And now all of a sudden, silence.
The speaker has shut up.
I'm Andrea H. I'm in Eastern Health Employee. I'm married. I have two children in school. And I have two senior parents. And I guess when you ask, how does this budget affect me? It's like, how doesn't this budget affect me? I sat with my father the other day, and he's been out of the hospital this winter, and he's on several different medications, and you're sitting and he's wondering how he's going to pay it. You know, and he has three loving children, and we will support him. My parents will be okay. Our children, we will be able to feed them. We will be able to clothe them. We put in a wood stove because we didn't know after Derek and Elle if we would have heat in the coldest of winter. So I know our house will be warm. You know, I agree. I don't know if we'll have much disposable income. But I know this election my husband ran. And I know from the stories he brought home, from being on the doors, that there's many families, that's what I think about, will have to decide, do I feed or do I heat? Do I clothe? And I think of him. I think of him. I think with this budget, just as it rolls out, little bits by little bits, you know, I wonder, you know, I've been 20 years in healthcare, so I feel secure about my job, but I wonder where the cuts are, what will be the implication for my work there. And frontline workers, we always do what needs to be done because we are there with the families. When I saw, I have a child with special needs, so I know in education how we need the struggles we have had to keep our son Jerry in the mainstream. And I know what it's like to get student assistance cut. And you're trying to problem solve with a teacher who has maybe three or four other children there who also has extra needs while she's trying to put in a regular curriculum. And you know, and they meet with us extra outside of school hours. They try to be flexible and try to do something different in the classroom. We've had two really challenging years, I have to say. So I do worry and I get confused when they push forward in a time of restraint. And I'm not oblivious. I know we're in a financial crisis. We do need to make decisions that are smart. Why push forward with a full day care? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Why push forward when in time you're asking the service to cut back? Right. Struggling to meet the needs of these children that they're trying to include into their classroom with minimal resources. Sean and I are sitting down and we are crunching the numbers. We're mid class, and we will help our senior parents. We will make sure the needs of our children are met. We will go down to one car. We will figure it out. But I just feel like we all talk about this boom And I never really got to experience this boom. Like, we never suffered, but like, we never struggled, but we never had, like, it was like this epic party. And now we're seeing, like, we're left with the bill. I, like, and I guess what, that's what I feel like.
Thanks for that. And I think a point that when people talk about the minister or anybody else for that matter about ratios, student or teacher pupil ratios, that the inclusion policy of including kids with exceptionalities in the classroom really changes the dynamic there. And that policy can only work if it has the proper supports to go with it. Other than that, the teacher's left in essentially in a practically impossible position of trying to cope with both a regular class, which is headache enough, and if they have a number of kids with various types of exceptionalities, it's more than it's reasonable to expect from somebody.
With 30 students, there are two different grade levels in the same classroom.
Yeah. Yeah. Hi, Earl, Lorraine, Joan Andrews. I'm here. I can talk to the dental program because I administered a lot of it as I'm a denturist. A lot of the problem that arose from that program, while it was great, was government was never, ever, ever realized how many people would actually be able to go on it. Which means that, and it, the influx was amazing, it was unbelievable. So what you have here is you have people who are just living above the poverty line, on the poverty line, or below the poverty line on this dental program. So you have all of your seniors, you have all of your people who have children in school, and you have all the children who are 18 and 17, who I saw in my clinic with no teeth, who were able to avail of it. So the sheer number, the sheer volume of people living in Newfoundland who do not have money right now, who are just above the poverty line, is staggering. The program, yes, needs to be there. The seniors definitely need it. I've gone to see them, I've gone to the homes, I've gone to Labrador, I've gone to everywhere. Everybody avails of it. Never would you have expected most of Newfoundland would be on be below that line or just above it. Should never have happened. We're taking away their jobs. We're taking away students being able to get educated. We're taking away people in politics, in government, who stand behind the people and who will not lie, who will stand behind themselves and for the people. There's a big problem. I had customers that have been waiting since September because I have gotten absolutely no things coming in from the MCB program since September. This has been shut down long ago. They were just waiting and waiting. Of course, we phone because all our patients are calling and they're saying, Joan, like, I've been waiting since October. I've been waiting since September. I've been waiting since July. Where's my teeth? Well, I have to wait till I get the okay to do that. So these people are all waiting, they're all calling the clinic, and nobody saw this coming. Not a soul. We had no idea, nobody had any idea. So when this came down last week, and I knew it was going to come down, I had to call all my patients, and I had to say, well, it's gone. You've been waiting all this time, and it's gone. I have one lady call. Her mother is in the Masonic home. She has no teeth. And she said to me, this is really something. She said to me, she said, Joan, she said, so you're going to tell me that my mother's losing her home, she's having to go on food that is microwaved, that will be no more nutritious for these seniors. They're already lacking in a lot of nutrients and minerals, especially iron. And now you're going to take my teeth, you're not going to let me have any teeth to chew this garbage with. And above it all, you're going to tax me, you're going to put a levy on top of my head to pay for you to do this to me. I mean, that's crazy. That's unbelievable. It should never happen. And the only thing I can tell you, just before I came here, I was late coming because I had to go back to the clinic because I had a lady call from Carbonier, who her husband is a senior, had all of his teeth extracted in preparation for having this program, getting their teeth, and then he just got a letter saying, no, we're not going to do it. So here's a senior with no teeth, who I will make teeth for, certainly. He will not be without them, but I can't do that for everybody, you know? So he has these teeth that have been extracted. I've already said, look, come in and look after it. But, you know, I can't afford to do that because I had to cut down one car too, you know? So that's what's going on. It's The government really didn't know how many people were living just above or below the poverty level, and how can you expect these people to pay a levy to be taxed like that? How can we live here? And how can we put all these beautiful things on TV saying, listen, boys, come to Newfoundland. You can come here, but you can't afford to drive around in gas. You can't get from one spot to the other. And if you do try to drive around in gas, what's going to happen? You're going to go down in a pothole.
They're going to have to change those ads and say, come to Newfoundland, where the seniors have no teeth. Come to Newfoundland, where we're the only province that taxes books, and where we close our libraries, and we wonder why we have the highest level of illiteracy in the country. Those aren't going to be very pretty ads.
Hi, my name is Ashley Tollison. I'm actually up here to talk about a bunch of women that a lot of people don't even think about. And that's women's in the jails, like Clarenville, and are now down in the pen. They have a lot of programs that they're no longer able to get because of the new budget. But on top of that, money that was taken from them is now literally going to be food coming from their mouths. There's also a huge problem with money that's being literally wasted, taxpayers' money that's being thrown in the garbage. And they're still saying that there's no programs for these women. They're coming out of jail, a lot of them with no teeth. And now I'm just hearing that they're not going to get any. No educational programs except for one classroom where you go in and you maybe do work and maybe you don't. No programs to help them deal with the outside world once they get here. Most of them don't even know how to boil water. They never had to. They were brought up either with parents that were in the systems or were on drugs or drinking, and they were never taught them. And they still come out, they go in there for how many months, come back out, and there's nowhere for them to turn because there's nothing out there for them. And then people don't want to hire people because they can't get a letter of conduct. And I know for a fact that with my mother who needed home care workers, I had one of them, or many, many, but one in particular, that literally cleaned out all my mother's bank account, and she had her letter of conduct. And I've known a lot of people that were criminals who have had trouble with the law, wouldn't even take so much as a piece of bread from somebody. So I don't know what's going to happen for these women when they do come out. There's a lot of things that need to be changed. And the way the money is being spent for the institutions, the women sure as hell ain't getting it, because I've seen it firsthand. And they're just pushed under the rug or behind some dumpster and told, you just stay there, don't worry about it, you can come back to jail next week. It's not right, and they need to change things fast.
Thank you very much.
Hi, my name is Helen Webster. I'm glad you like Gamma. I'm from the area. Hope you've been good to you. I'm here to talk about the budget.
Okay.
So, in any case, we have a lot of soul searching to do that all of us have to join together. Seniors, students, working people, single mothers, every group that I can think of must join together to fight this levy. Now, I'm a computer engineering student, okay? Took a year off from medical. I can't stay here. I can't get a job here, okay? I'm single with no kids. Okay, so it affects me too. I've lost my heating rebate, my dental is gone, so whatever teeth I got, better hang on to them. They haven't took the eyelashes, okay? A lot of other cuts, the prescription drug program was reduced, my rent's gone off. And by the way, another thing, Earl, you need to really hammer home on, my dear lad, is this rent control. We need it. That will get you support right across the ground. I want to drop that in your lips, okay? If anybody's been to McDonald's lately, guys, have they served a filled in Newfoundlander yet? Because another thing, too, we must think about is that this levy, now I'm not a lawyer, I studied engineering, okay? So I know engineering inside it, but a lawyer, is it possible, Earl, you may want to look into this, and Lorraine, you too. Is it unconstitutional, according to the Canadian Charter of Rights, the first article, that any Canadian has the right to live in their province in this country? It's guaranteed on the Bill of Rights and the Canadian Charter. This levy will force people to move. I know one lady spoke here tonight, she's going to be moving. I'm looking at the same option, going back to the mainland, because I am not going to pay for a deficit I did not run off. The people in Newfoundland are paying for a $2.6 billion deficit they never ran off. And when it comes to her choice, how hard was it to say no to Nelcor for $1.3 billion? This is what I want to know. How hard was it for them to give Nelcor $1.3 billion at the same time? I never had kids, and but I do like children. God love them. They even trimmed the snacks at the Janeway and the stickers to the Janeway. The only thing they haven't done yet is take the teddy bears in there and auction them to pay Nelcor. I believe that this province is heading down a very bad path. It's up to us to decide its fate.
Thank you very much.
Hi, my name's Tim, and I'm coming here tonight as an extremely concerned citizen. For a bit of background on myself, my fiance and I, we're trying to get our lives back on, like trying to get our lives started. She's, you know, we work both very good jobs. She's a nurse with Eastern Health. I work with a community group down here, right here in St. John's, that provides community services to refugees and immigrants in the province. And it's just as a quick note, I want to point out that this new levy, this also extends to recently arrived refugees in the province too. Yeah, like it's like recently arrived Syrian refugees are now responsible for this levy as well. Making them pay for a deficit they literally had nothing to do with. But that's not, but... Yeah, that's my reaction too. But my main point is that, you know, we work both very good jobs. You know, we're trying to get our lives together. We just recently purchased a house, recently just before Christmas. We're trying to save for a wedding in the fall. And I'm already working two jobs, trying to cover everything. And we're fortunate enough that, I guess in a way, we're fortunate enough that we don't have the concern of childcare. We don't have the concern of having to feed more mouths than what we have ourselves. But it's getting to the point that we don't know if we can afford to feed more mouths. We don't know if we can even really afford to stay. And frankly, if we didn't just sign a 5-year mortgage, we'd be probably considering leaving. And I don't know what else to do. And with the when I hear the liberals saying they just wait for the fall when the next budget comes. Yeah, when really both of our jobs are really up on the chopping block potentially. I'm at a loss. I don't know what we're gonna do. Just right now, we're hurting strong, but how much longer can we hold?
Thank you. Go ahead, Michael.
Hi, Debbie Forward. I'm a registered nurse, and I'm president of the Registered Nurses Union. A number of people have talked about healthcare tonight from a different perspective than the one I'm going to bring, and it concerns me a great deal when I look at this current budget. And few people have mentioned what the fall might hold in store. And as bad as this budget is, I have huge concerns about what is going to come to us in the fall. Earl said everything is on the table, and you may have heard that the departments were all told to find 30%. Mm-hmm. In this budget, the health authorities had or found 1.7% of savings. 1.7%. And those impacts are huge. We saw, you know, we're seeing 40 beds being closed, 40 long-term care beds being closed. We're seeing mental health services reduced. We're seeing changes to the laundry services and kitchen services. We're seeing a unit being closed at the Waterford. We're seeing a dialysis service removed from Harbour Breton. We're seeing community clinics being closed in central Newfoundland where they won't have access to healthcare unless they drive for half an hour. We're seeing a nursing clinic closing in Black Tickle. We're seeing the hours in the OR being reduced in Cornbrook, and that's just some of the changes. We're seeing x-ray hours being reduced in rural, parts of rural of the province. That's 1.7%.
Wow.
I'm really afraid of what's going to happen to healthcare when they start looking for 5 or 10%.
Wow.
And, you know, I think they're paving the road, like someone said, to privatization, which is a huge concern. I had my mother, who I thought, well, I've talked to my mother a lot. She said she was in Florida when the budget came down. She's a very healthy 87-year-old lady. She's very lucky. And like the other lady said, you know, I look after my mom. She'll be okay with, you know, she'll be okay. She's got two children and we'll make sure she's okay. And but she said to me, I said, you know, Mom, they brought in lots of user fees. And she said, yes, I heard that. She said, I heard they might bring in a user fee for healthcare. She said, you know, I probably could pay $5 or $10 if I needed an x-ray.
Oh.
I did, and then I did a lecture for my mother about user fees. And she said, okay, Debbie, I get it, they're bad. And I said, yes, Mom, they're bad. Because we shouldn't have to pay user fees. That's why we have public health care, and we need to defend public health care. Because it is what... You know, it is what this country is built our, I think, our legacy around. I also believe that there are lots of efficiency to be found in healthcare. So I'm not standing here and saying that we're doing it all right, because actually, you know, we as an organization put forward lots of solutions to government in terms of finding efficiencies. But I am concerned that they're going to look at privatization. You know, I am concerned that they're going to reduce services drastically. So what we're seeing today is just the tip of the iceberg. And I think we need to make sure we stand up for what we believe in healthcare, and public healthcare is just one piece of that.
Go ahead, Adam.
All right, Adam Case, Mount Burrell, and I'm a student. Another demographic this government decided to punch in the mouth. So here's what, I am a student, and up until a couple weeks ago, Newfoundland and Labrador was bragging, rightly so, about a government that didn't have student loans and had a very progressive regime for its students. The provincial government, in its infinite McWisdom, decided that it would be a grand idea to reintroduce student loans. This is what any first-year economics student tells you, this is objectively a dumb idea. A better educated workforce is a workforce that's capable of innovating, diversifying, creating new business opportunities, and people who tend to come here for the free education stay here, the exact opposite of what they're doing now. So, if it's a shame the finance minister isn't here, I'd like her to explain to me, or Mr. Ball to explain to me, how, so I graduate with $30,000 worth of student loan debt, I can't do a mortgage, can't do a car, can't buy any necessities that I would buy moving out or what have you, I can't contribute to the economy, nobody gets any money, nobody can hire anyone else. I leave here, that's one less brain that you have to resuscitate the economy that's in a recession, so you end up shrinking your economy. Explain to me how this is a good idea, and I know you guys have done this before, but I would like to just, there can never be enough reminders, it's always a great idea to have you guys, or you, or whoever, stand up in House Assembly and remind our colleagues that a better educated economy is a more youthful, dynamic economy, not based on one thing, fish, oil, Muskrat Falls, and that if you want to end this recession, give MUN the money that would not cause your vice presidents to make nasty blog posts about you, and make education affordable to the point where it's free, and so uh, And in my view, the beginning of the end of this recession begins with four words. Education is a right.